Now that we have discussed the concept of radians, it's time to move on to the unit circle. So, because I'm introducing the concept of radians, I'm still going to use both degrees and radians to describe the various angles in the circle. If we look at an arbitrary circle drawn in front of you, the circle of course lives in two dimensions. You need two axes to describe it. You have the x-axis and of course you have the y-axis. Now, any point in 2D space or any point in the circle requires two numbers to describe it. We need an x-coordinate and a y-coordinate. So the important pieces on the circle would be the angle of the, we'll say at the angle, the radius, and the two coordinates to describe the point on the circle. We now require some revision on right-angled triangles. The definition of cosine of theta is the adjacent over the hypotenuse, or the adjacent side of the over the hypotenuse. The definition of sine theta is the opposite side divided by the hypotenuse. This is illustrated on the top right of your screen. Note that I've defined theta as being here. Now if I defined, let's say I defined alpha being up here, then the opposite would be, and the adjacent would have to swap sides. But for where I've defined theta, the adjacent is here, and the opposite side is here. Finally then, the hypotenuse is up here. Now for reasons you'll see in a moment, I'm going to define the hypotenuse as r. So instead of the hypotenuse, I'm going to write r. For this reason, we can say that cosine theta is the adjacent side divided by r, and sine theta is the opposite side divided by r. If we rearrange these, we find that the adjacent side is r cos theta, and the opposite side is r sine theta. So to say that again, the adjacent side is r cos theta, and the opposite side is r sine theta. We can view this graphically as follows, where we define the hypotenuse as r. The point, any point on the circle, we'll say any point later on in a circle, can be described as having an x-coordinate and a y-coordinate. Now, the opposite is r times the sine of theta, and that is, of course, going to correspond to the y-side or the y-coordinate. Then r, the hypotenuse times cosine theta, corresponds to the x side or the x coordinate. So this is the adjacent of theta and this is the opposite of theta. Because of this then, we can sub in for x and y up here as having coordinate or cos theta or sine theta. Where a circle has a radius of 1 or 1 unit, we speak of it as being a unit circle. So that means the points in the unit circle are 1, 0, so x is equal to 1, y is equal to 0, 0, 1, so x is equal to 0, y is equal to 1, minus 1, 0, x is equal to minus 1, y is equal to 0, and 0, minus 1, x is equal to 0, y is equal to minus 1. Any point in this circle has a coordinate x and y. Now we can drop parallel and perpendicular lines here and create a right triangle. If we note here, the right triangle's hypotenuse corresponds to the radius of the circle, and that's why I was using r as the hypotenuse earlier on. This allows us to use all of the results of our right triangle, which I've discussed here. So plugging all those in onto our unit circle, we have the following diagram. The radius is still 1. Any point in the circle is still described by x and y coordinates. The x coordinate is the adjacent, so it's r cosine theta, but the radius is equal to 1, so x is simply cosine theta. Similarly, the opposite side is r sine theta, but the radius is of magnitude 1, so simply y is equal to sine theta. This means that any point in the circle is simply described by cos theta sine theta. X is equal to cos theta, y is equal to sine theta. Now it's time to start looking at the various angles on the unit circle and see if we can calculate their cosine and sine. So I'm going to shrink the diagram in front of you and let's move on. So remember, any point is described by cosine theta equals x and sine theta equals y, where the radius is equal to 1. But that describes any point in the circle at any angle. What would happen if we went to 0 degrees or 0 radians? So we brought this black line right down, which I've described here. So we have the black line describing any angle in the circle, and we bring it right down to the x-axis. So we only have one blue line corresponding to one of the lines up here. So it should be clear to you that we have no sine component, because here x has the value of 1 and y has the value of 0. But x corresponds to cosine theta and y corresponds to sine theta. This means that the cosine of 0 degrees, or the cosine of 0 radians, is equal to 1, but also that's of course equal to cosine of 360 degrees or twice pi radians. Similarly, the sine of 0 degrees, or the sine of 0 radians, is equal to 0, which of course is equal to the sine of 360 degrees or twice pi radians. So you can now say that the cos of naught is 1 and the sine of naught is naught. In a similar fashion, we're going to look at what happens when theta is equal to 90 degrees. So we have our arbitrary angle on the circle over here, and we bring the point corresponding to the red dot up onto 90 degrees. So we see here that 90 degrees on the unit circle corresponds to x is equal to 0, y is equal to 1. And this of course means that cosine theta is equal to 0. So we can say that the cosine of 90 degrees, or the cosine of pi over 2 radians, is 0. We can say that the sine of 90 degrees, or the sine of pi over 2 radians, is equal to 1. So now we can say the cos of naught is 1, the sine of naught is naught. The cos of 90 is equal to naught, and the sine of 90 is equal to 1. Let's continue and look at another angle, when theta is equal to 180 degrees, or pi radians. Once again, we have the circle, or the angle corresponding to any point in the circle, and we bring the point here over to the point corresponding to 180 degrees, or pi radians. Once again, x is equal to minus 1 here, and y is equal to 0. But we know x is equal to cosine theta, and y is equal to sine theta. And this means that the cosine of 180 degrees, or the cosine of pi radians, is negative 1. The sine of 180 degrees, or the sine of pi radians, is 0. On to the final angle, which we will do in this manner. Once again, we begin at the arbitrary point on the unit circle, and we move this point to that which corresponds with 270 degrees, or 3 pi over 2 radians. Here, on the unit circle, x is equal to 0 and y is equal to minus 1. X, of course, is cosine of 3 pi over 2 and y is sine pi 3 pi over 2. This means that the cosine of 270 degrees, or 3 pi over 2 radians, is 0. And the sine of 270 degrees, or 3 pi over 2 radians, is minus 1. Calculating the cosine and sine when theta is equal to 45 degrees, or pi over 4 radians, is slightly more difficult. So I've set up the unit circle here, even though I haven't drawn the outline of the circumference. We still have, of course, the point 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, and 0, minus 1. We still have an arbitrary point on the circumference of the circle, and that's going to correspond to x is equal to r cos theta, y is equal to r sine theta. But the radius is equal to 1, so basically y is sine pi over 4 and x is cos pi over 4, as we have seen in the past. How do we actually calculate what x and y are? It's not so simple as 1, 0 or 0, 1 or whatever as we had in the past. By definition, a triangle with 45 degrees here is made up when the x length and the y length are equal. So for this reason, I'm going to say that x is equal to y is equal to L. And I'm going to use the Pythagoras theorem. So the hypotenuse squared is the sum of the adjacent squared plus the opposite squared. So r squared, the radius, well, that's simply going to be 1 squared. X squared plus y squared is simply going to be L squared plus L squared, or twice L squared. Rearranging, we see that the length L is equal to 1 over root 2. So now we can say that x and y are both 1 over root 2. So just rearranging, this means that the cosine of pi over 4, or the cosine of 45 degrees, is 1 over root 2. And so is the sine of pi over 4, or the sine of 45 degrees. The most tricky angle to calculate the sine and cosine of is when the angle corresponds to 60 degrees in your triangle. How do we do this? Well, we have to do a bit of a geometric argument here. So I'm going to extend or double my triangle. So I'm going to take the triangle which is up here and extend it to the right hand side. So we have our 60 degree angle here, as we did a moment ago. Well, because it's a right triangle, we have to have 180 degrees. That means we have 90 degrees plus 60 degrees, meaning that the remaining angle has to be 30 degrees. So with our mirror triangle, we have, of course, the exact same angles. The length will be as follows. Because it's a mirror, this one, that was the radius 1. This means this also has a length of 1. If you look at the two angles up here, they also correspond to 60 degrees. And what this means is that we have a triangle, a bigger triangle now, with a 60 degree angle, a 60 degree angle, and a 60 degree angle. How is this of use to us? Well, we've seen a moment ago that every side which is opposite 60 degrees has a length of 1. So this is opposite this angle here has a length of 1. This is opposite this angle has a length of 1. And this suggests that this angle here, which is opposite this, will have a length of 1 here. This side will have a length of 1. This is useful, of course, because we are interested in this segment of the length, which of course corresponds to 1/2. So we found that x here is equal to 1/2. In order to calculate the length of the y side, we utilize the Pythagoras theorem again. The details of which are here, you can go through those yourself. We see that the length of the y side corresponds to root 3 over 2. Putting it all together, we find that the cosine of pi over 3, or 60 degrees, is 1/2. And the sine of pi over 3, or 60 degrees, is root 3 over 2. The final angle we have to calculate is what happens when theta is 30 degrees, or pi over 6. It shouldn't be a big jump to realize that this, in fact, is the same triangle as we had a moment ago, but using the other angle, namely 30 degrees. So this means that we just need to swap the lengths. So it means the cos of 30 degrees, or pi over 3, is root 3 over 2, and the sine of 30 degrees, or pi over 3, is going to be 1/2. Pardon me, I just noticed a typo. 30 degrees corresponds to pi over 6. It is 60 degrees which corresponds to pi over 3. Finally, so, putting it all together, we can look at the angle in degrees, the angle in radians, the cosine of the angle, and the sine of the angle. And I've written all of the results of the last couple of minutes there in front of you. So that's all I've got to say about that. Thanks for watching. Please pass it on to your friends. Subscribe to my YouTube channel, and you might also check out universityphysicstutorials.com.